is another reason.
It's so lovely to hear you singing.
من چقدر عزیزان خوشحال بودم وقتی شما داشتید میخوندید.
Even though I don't understand everything that you're singing.
با اینکه همه چیزی که شما میخوندید نمیفهمیدم.
I love the open heart that you have as you praise the Lord.
و این قلب بازی که شما دارید برای خداوند من خیلی خوشحالم.
And it's a delightful thing to come away from the world and to be in the presence of God.
و چقدر خوب است که ما از این دنیا میایم و در مقابل این خداوندمون قرار میگیریم با خوشحالی.
I want to speak with you this evening about spiritual gifts.
امشب میخوام در مورد هدایای روحانی با شما صحبت کنم.
We began this actually at the retreat.
ما این رو اگه یادتون باشه در اردویی که بودیم شروع کردیم اونجا.
And several of you said, you know, we need a little bit more time with this.
و بعضی از شما گفتیم ما این سری وقت بیشتری لازم داریم در موردش.
And so tonight we're going to take it a little further.
و برای همین امشب یه مقدار بیشتر روش کار می‌کنیم.
So how much time do we have?
You have time, you know, until you have energy.
You better tell them that.
از من پرسیدن که چقدر وقت می‌گذره از هم چقدر شما می‌تونید انرژی داشته باشید، صحبت کنید، توان داشته باشید.
So there are four passages in the Bible that talk about this subject of spiritual gifts.
چهار قسمت از کتاب مقدس هست که در مورد این هدایای روحانی صحبت میشه.
And when you read them, you will realize that the Christian church is not just about one person who stands at the front and everybody else just sits there and listens.
و وقتی شما میخونید این آیات رو میفهمید که کلیسای مسیح کلیسایی است که فقط یک نفر اونجا وایسه، فقط به اون همه چی باشه.
So as we walk through this session tonight,
و همونطور که امشب مرور ما میکنیم این مطالب رو،
you all have homework.
شما یک سری تکالیف خواهید داشت.
Understand?
متوجه شدید؟
You all have homework tonight.
امشب شما همه تکالیف خواهید داشت.
I want you to listen very carefully.
من میخوام شما خوب توجه کنید.
I want you to be thinking, well, which of these gifts sounds most like me?
من میخوام فکر کنید که کدوم یکی از این هدایا به شما بیشتر میخوره.
And then when you find the answer,
وقتی شما جواب رو پیدا کردید,
your homework will only have begun.
اون تازه تکلیف شما شروع شده.
Because what this is about the way in which each one of us are uniquely gifted to serve the King of Kings.
Amen.
اون چیزی که هست اینه که هر کدوم از ما به طور خیلی ویژه‌ای برای پادشاهی خدا تعیین شدیم اینجا که خدمتی رو انجام بدیم.
So that these three chapters right here, 1 Corinthians 12, 13 and 14 are a major part of the Bible that talks about spiritual gifts.
اول قرنتیان باب 12 13 و 14 قسمت اعظمی است که صحبت می‌کنه از این هدایای روحانی.
And each of these passages that are listed here have teaching about spiritual gifts.
و هر کدوم از اینها در مورد هدایای روحانی آموزش داره.
I want you to know that God knows exactly who you are.
می‌خوام شما بدونید که خداوند دقیقاً می‌دونه شما کی هستید.
He knows what you have.
خداوند می‌دونه شما چی دارید.
And he knows how you could serve him optimally.
و خداوند می‌دونه چطور می‌تونید او را خدمت نمایید.
And tonight we would like for you to find out what that is.
و امشب ما می‌خوام شما رو کمک کنیم که بدونید که این خدمت شما چی هست.
He knows all about your environment.
خداوند در مورد محیط‌های شما می‌دونه.
He knows exactly what has happened in your life and what has gone right and what has gone wrong.
دقیقا خدا میدونه چه اتفاقی در زندگی شما درست یا غلط اتفاق افتاده.
And just now something has gone wrong, it looks like.
Okay.
Here we are. And so it seems that only Pastor Siamek knows how to make sense out of one little piece of the screen. But I want you to understand that God knows everything about you.
من می‌خوام اینو از شما بدونید که خداوند همه چی رو در مورد شما می‌دونه.
And you may wonder, well, why some things happen in your life?
و شما ممکنه بدونید خب تعجب کنید یعنی چرا هر چیزی تو زندگی شما داره اتفاق میفته.
But God likes to take all of the things of your life and turn them into good.
ولی خدا میخواد همه چیزی که زندگی شما داره اتفاق میفته رو تبدیل به چیز نیکو بکنه.
So that God is able to take the things that have happened for evil and turn even those things into good.
آمین.
یعنی خدا به اون چیزی که شریر در زندگی شما اتفاق میفته رو میتونه تبدیل بکنه به نیکویی و خیر.
آمین.
So some of the hardest parts of my life.
برای من بعضی از سخت‌ترین قسمت‌های زندگی من.
Things that I did not want to happen to me.
چیزایی که من نمی‌خواستم برای من اتفاق بیفته.
Those very things have turned out to be some of the strongest parts of my life.
اونها شده مهمترین و بزرگترین قسمت‌های زندگی من.
So when we have had things that have been especially painful and difficult,
بنابراین اگر چیزهایی در زندگی ما بسیار سخت و دردناک بوده,
God loves to take those very things.
خداوند می‌خواد همونها رو بگیره.
And teach you how to understand them.
و به شما آموزش بده چطور اونها رو متوجه بشید.
And he will use those very things that were the most difficult in your life for good.
ما خداوند اون از اون چیزایی که بسیار سخت بود تو زندگی شما اونها رو تبدیل به نیکویی کنه.
When my wife and I moved to Waterloo many years ago,
ما به شهر واترلو سالیان پیش اومدیم.
Our first 4 years there were very difficult.
4 سال اول خیلی زندگی سخت.
Very discouraging in just about every way.
و از هر طرف هر جهتی ما ناامید بودیم.
And I thought, couldn't there be some place in the whole wide world where we could be better off than here?
میشه خودم فکر می‌کردم میتونه یه جای دیگه تو این دنیا باشه که لااقل شاید از اینجای خود بهتر باشه.
I said to my wife, I'd be willing to go anywhere.
من به زنم گفتم که من دوست دارم هر جای دیگه‌ای برم.
But she said they have to speak English.
بعد به اونا بتونن به زبان انگلیسی صحبت کنن.
But it seems there was no place that wanted us.
ولی به نظر میاد هیچ جایی هیچ جا ما رو نمی‌خواستن.
So we had to stay where we were.
ما بنابراین مجبور شدیم همونجا بمونیم.
We learned some very hard lessons there.
ولی درس‌های سری سختی رو یاد گرفتیم.
And those very same hard lessons.
ولی همون درس‌های بسیار سخت
have borne fruit for many years now.
آمین.
میوه‌های بسیاری در طول سال‌ها داشت.
هللویا.
I tell you, I did not understand. I did not want this. But the very things that I did not want have turned out to bear fruit for the glory of God. So God knows about your environment. He knows how much money you don't have. He knows the family that you have. Maybe not the one you wish you had. He knows all about your immigration status. You hear that?
Yes.
He knows all about you. He knows about your personality. That you are all different. Some of you are more quiet. Some of you are hoping that I won't pick on you right now. But I might. So some of us are outgoing and noisy. Some of us like to take lots of time to make up our decisions. Others say, just do it. He knows about us. He knows about our passions, the things that matter deeply to us. I remember teaching a class on this years ago. And I was talking about passions with this group. And the one man in the group was an engineer or a math student, I think. He said, I can't make any sense of this passions. He said, I don't have any passions. So I said to him, so when you are reading the newspaper or watching the news on television, what are the kinds of things that upset you? And you say, come here and look at this. Oh, he said, that's easy. He said, whenever there's waste, I can't stand that. So he became the treasurer of our church.
خزانه دار کلیسای ما.
We wanted somebody that doesn't want to waste.
ما کسی رو دوست داشتیم که هیچ وقت همه چی رو از دست نده.
I don't know what I did here. I must have. I don't know. Oh, there we are. Can you bring that up? Yes. Oops. I think there are too many buttons on this thing for me. Oops. So he knows about our environment, he knows about our personality, our passions, he knows about our relationship with him.
پس برای خدا در مورد شرایط ما، شخصیت ما، علاقه‌های ما و ارتباط ما با او می‌دونه.
He knows whether we have learned to walk with him.
خدا می‌دونه که ما آیا دوست داریم که با او راه بریم.
He knows whether we have big faith or tiny faith.
می‌دونه که آیا ما یک ایمان بزرگ داریم، ایمان کوچولو داریم.
And he knows what our spiritual gifts are.
و با خداوند می‌دونه اون هدیه‌های روحانی ما.
This is a little bit different than our natural talents.
این یه مقدار فرق میکنه از اون استعدادهای طبیعی ما.
No, some of us are good at math.
بعضی هم مثلا در ریاضی خوبیم.
Others say, بعضی
هم میگن نه من اصلا بدم میاد.
So we have different talents.
بنابراین ما استعدادهای مختلفی داریم.
Some of us are good with our hands.
بعضی هم با دستکار دستی خیلی خوب هستیم.
Others are clumsy.
بعضی هم خیلی تنبلی هستیم.
Yes. Now I want to read this passage from 1 Corinthians.
من می‌خوام این آیه از اول قرنتیان بخونم براتون.
Now to each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good.
بنابراین به هر کس فرستاده شدن روح برای داده شده برای یک علت نیکو.
Now listen carefully.
خوب گوش کنید.
He says that this expression of the Holy Spirit is given to each one for the common good.
که روح مقدس به روح قدس به هر کدوم از شما اهدا شده برای یک محصول نیکو.
He gives you this manifestation of the Spirit not so that you can be a special person and say, oh, well, I have this manifestation of the Spirit.
اینطوری است که فقط یه نفر بره یه جایی واسه فقط بگه من فقط هستم که این روح مقدس بر من اومده.
No, he gives us these gifts for the common good, for the good of everybody.
بلکه این روح مقدس بر همه برای یک کار مشترک برای همه هستش.
To one there is given through the Spirit the message of wisdom. What should I do here? You want to translate this as we go?
Yes, I'm going to read it through the Bible.
Okay. 1 Corinthians 12. Verse 8.
Okay. زیرا یکی را به واسطت روح کلام حکمت داده می شود، دیگری را کلام علم بر اساس همان، و یکی را ایمان به همان روح، و دیگری را نعمت‌های شفا دادن به همان روح، و یکی را قوت معجزات و دیگری را نبوت، و یکی را تمیز ارواح و دیگری را احسان زبان‌ها و دیگری را ترجمه زبان‌ها.
All these are the work of the one and the same Spirit, and he gives to them to each one just as he determines.
اما در جمعی اینها همان یک روح فاعل است که هر نفر را فردن به اساس اراده خود تقسیم می‌کند.
Then he goes on to say in this passage.
و اینطور ادامه میده در همین آیات.
That it's like our body has all different parts.
که مثلا میگه مثلا اینکه بدن ما اعضای مختلف داره.
He says, can you imagine if their whole body was just one big eye?
مثلا میتونید آیا میتونید تصور کنید که فقط یک بدن فقط تمامش یه چشم باشه؟
Well, how strange that would be.
این چقدر میتونه عجیب غریب باشه؟
No, he says, he has put all different gifts into the body just as he intended.
بلکه میگه نه اینطور نیست، بلکه بر این بدن بر هر کدوم اینها یک هدیه قرار داده شده.
And what I'm showing you here is only a short list.
من چیزی که اینجا براتون دارم فقط یک لیست کوتاهی هست.
But I will give you the full list as we move along.
من یه فهرست کامل هم بهشون خواهم داد که میریم جلوتر.
Here we are. So there are some people who are some gifts that are actually people.
بعضی ها این هدیه بهشون داده شده، هدیه مردمی.
So there are some people who are apostles, prophets, evangelists, teachers, and pastors. Those are all people.
این مردم اینا هدیه هست به بعضی به صورت فرستاده هستن، بعضی به عنوان پیامبر، بعضی به عنوان باباشه، بعضی به عنوان معلم و بعضی به عنوان شبان.
And we're going to explain a little bit about each one of these.
و ما توضیح خواهیم داد در مورد هر کدوم از اینها.
And then there are other kind of communication gifts like wisdom and knowledge and encouragement and so on.
و بعضی دیگه نوع هدیه‌های ارتباطیه که مثلا بعضی حکمت دارن، بعضی دانش دارن، بعضی تشویق کننده هستن، بعضی کار اداری هستن، بعضی رهبری هستن، بعضی در دلسوزی و رحم هستن.
And some are clearly supernatural gifts like miracles, healing.
و بعضی ها دیگه هستن که هدیه‌های خارق‌العاده‌ای دارن، مثل شفا دادن، مثل معجزات، مثل تشخیص ارواح و صحبت به زبان‌ها و ترجمه زبان‌ها.
And then faith is listed as a gift.
و بعد ایمان به عنوان یک هدیه در اینجا.
It seems really foundational to everything.
با اینکه بیس و بنیان همه اینها هستش.
And then there are what I am calling support gifts. These are kind of behind the scenes gifts. So what does God want from me? So he knows my environment. Knows my personality. Knows my passions. Knows whether I'm born again or not. Knows my relationship with him. Knows what my spiritual gifts are. And so how do those all fit together into my calling or purpose?
حالا اینا همه‌شو چجوری میتونه به اون خواندگی من یا اون مسئولیت خدا برای من داره کار کنه؟
So that I can actually live with a purpose.
که بتونم با یک مقصود زندگی کنم.
There's a reason for me to be here.
بلی یه علتی هست که من اینجا هستم.
This was one of the most important things for me personally when I was coming to commit my own life to Christ.
یکی بزرگترین علتهایی که من اینجا هستم که بتونم خودم رو در اختیار خداوند برای مقصود او بذارم.
I wanted to believe that my own life somehow had meaning or purpose.
اینطوری هستش که من میفهمم که زندگی من یک معنی داره، یک مقصودی داره.
That I wasn't just here kind of wandering around and wondering why I'm here.
نه که فقط همینطوری ندونم اصلا کجا هستم، کجا دارم میام، چیکار دارم میکنم.
Because we want to live with a purpose both in the world as well as in the church.
برای اینکه ما دوست داریم که با یک مقصود هم در دنیا هم در کلیسا زندگی کنیم.
So we're going to look at each of because this is all a part of this eternal kingdom of God.
حالا ما همینا نگاه می‌کنیم برای اینکه نه همش ربط پیدا میشه به اون پادشاهی ابدی خداوند ما.
We want to live with a purpose because this isn't only for now but forever.
ما می‌خوام با یک مقصود زندگی کنیم نه فقط الان بلکه برای همیشه تا ابد.
So what's an apostle?
پس برای ما حالا بفهمیم که یک فرستاده یا رسول که تو کتاب مقدس اومده چی هست.
An apostle literally means somebody who is sent.
معنی لغویش این کسی که فرستاده شده.
They are sent out to proclaim the gospel, to start new churches, providing supervision and care for those churches, could be national or international.
یک فرستاده کسانی هستن که اونها اعلام میکنن در مورد خبر خوش، کلیساهای جدید رو شروع میکنن، بعد سرپرستی رو و توجهشون به اونهای چه کلیسایی که درست کردن، چه حالت ملی باشه چه حالت بین المللی.
There were 12 apostles and also some others.
ما می‌دونیم که 12 تا رسول بودن و بقیه‌شون.
So when you see somebody today who is acting like an apostle,
حالا اگه شما امروز کسی می‌بینید که داره کار یک فرستاده یا رسول انجام میده.
There are people today who do that kind of activity.
کسانی هستن که الان دارن کارا رو انجام میدن.
And sometimes we refer to them as apostles.
و بعضی وقتا اونها رو به عنوان فرستاده رسول مینامیم.
But you know something.
اما میدونی چیه؟
If somebody stands up and said,
اگه یکی اینجا بیسته و بگه اینطوری،
I am an apostle.
من رسول هستم.
That's not really what we're looking for.
این چیزی نیست که ما دنبالش داریم.
Remember that these gifts are given for the benefit of everybody, for others.
یادمون باشه که این هدایا برای نفع همه هستش.
They're not given so that we can have a reason, new reason for pride.
این چیزی نیست که ما بتونیم دلایلی برای مغرور شدن تکبر پیدا کنیم.
There is the gift of prophecy or prophets.
بعد یک هدیه هست، هدیه نبوت یا پیشگویی.
Literally, it's made, the word prophet is made up of two words.
این کلمه همین که گفته شد از در واقع دو کلمه پیشگویی درست شده.
To speak and before.
گفتن و از من پیش گفتن.
So it could mean that it's to speak before it happens.
یعنی در واقع چیزی رو بگید قبل از که اتفاق بیفته.
So it would be a prediction.
بنابراین میشه یک چیزی رو پیش بینی کردن.
So a prophecy could be that I predict that something is going to happen before it happens.
بنابراین یا قبل یا پیشگویی یعنی چیزی رو پیش بینی کردن قبل از که اتفاق بیفته.
It could mean to speak before the people in a public sense.
و بعض وقتا معنیش این هست که در مقابل عموم یه چیزی رو صحبت کردن.
Or it could mean to speak instead of or on behalf of.
یا گاهی اوقات در جای دیگری، در جای کسی دیگری صحبتی رو انجام دادن.
And so many times when you read about prophets in the Bible.
بنابراین وقتی شما خیلی جاها کتاب مقدس از کلمه پیشگو
They are speaking on behalf of God. They are speaking God's message, God's words.
اونها به عنوان جانشین خدا صحبت می‌کنند. اونها کلام خدا رو می‌گن.
And they tend to speak quite directly. You feel like God was speaking.
و اونها طوری صحبت می‌کنند که انگار خدا داره مستقیم باهاشون صحبت می‌کنه.
There is a kind of directness about it.
یک حالت مستقیم در این آدم حس می‌کنه.
So that this is different than explaining and teaching.
این خیلی فرق می‌کنه با آموزش دادن و توضیح دادن.
This includes this direct element that is strong and powerful, and you feel like God was speaking.
این عناصری در این نبوت وجود داره که انسان حس می‌کنه دقیقاً مستقیم خدا داره با او صحبت.
This word is used over 200 times in the New Testament.
این کلمه پیشگوی بیش از 200 بار در عهد جدید تکرار شد.
So all kinds of speaking is related to prophecy.
پس انواع اقسام صحبت کردن ها به این پیشگویی یا نبوت میرسه.
All knowledge and mysteries are called a prophecy in 1 Corinthians 13.
تمام اون دانش ها و اون معجزات برمیگرده به اون اسرار برمیگرده به همین پیشگویی در اول قرنتیان.
So prophets speak to strengthen, to comfort, to encourage.
بنابراین یک پروفت، یک کسی که پیشگو هست، این کارو میکنه که بتونه دیگران رو تشویق بکنه، دیگران رو قوت بده و به جلو ببره.
Evangelists.
و حالا مباشر صحبت میکنه.
Literally it means to bring the good news.
یعنی خبر خوش رو آوردن.
They readily and effectively communicate the gospel to unbelievers so that they respond with repentance and faith.
یعنی در واقع همیشه آماده است به طور مؤثر در ارتباط قرار بده مردم رو که غیر ایمان هستن به وسیله خبر خوش انجیل تا اونها بتونن به توبه و ایمان دست یابن.
So every Christian does this to some degree.
من می‌بینم که هر مسیحی تا یه اندازه این کار رو انجام میده.
But some people are exceptional at this.
و بعضیا ولی خیلی فوق‌العاده هستن در این مورد.
They just have a freedom to do this and there's a responsiveness which is unmistakable.
و بعضیا اینقدر راحت این کار رو انجام میدن که دقیقاً هم می‌بینن که چه قدرتی در پاسخ به کارشون به مباشرتشون هست.
There are pastors and shepherds.
بعد دیگه نوبت کسایی هستن که شیشا هستن و یا شبانان هستن.
No, literally it means they shepherd a flock.
یعنی در واقع معنی لغویش اینه که شبانی کردن یک گله.
It's to nurture and care for and guide people towards spiritual maturity.
که اونها رو خوراک بدن روحانی و اونها رو هدایت بکنن به این به صورت روحانی.
I remember you have homework.
ما بیاید نه شما تکلیف دارید.
You're supposed to be listening and saying, "Is one of these kind of like me?"
Sorry.
Is one of these kind of like me?
بعد شاید پیش الان فکر کردی که یکی از اینا که من خودم هستم که این هدیه رو دارم.
So, shepherding and pastoring is kind of an informal thing where we talk to people and connect with them and are able to interact with them so that we are caring for them. Both as individuals, but we're doing it among the whole group or the whole flock.
شبانی یا کشیش بودن در واقع یه جوری است که اون شخص این هدیه رو داره که با تک تک اشخاص ارتباطی برقرار میکنه یا میتونه در اونها رو به فکر اونها هست چه شخصی که شخصی یا به صورت عمومی.
Shepherds guard and protect.
بنابراین اون شبان پشتیبانی میکنه و محافظت میکنه.
They feed, nourish, and lead the sheep to pasture.
و اونها رو به سوی مزارع سرسبز اونها رو هدایت میکنه.
They look for the ones that are lost and care for the sick or injured.
و اونهایی که گم شدن دنبالشون هست، اونهایی که زخمی هستند، اونها رو دنبالشون هست که اونها رو نگهداری کنه.
They are aware of when rest is needed.
و وقتی که لازم هست اونها استراحت بکنن، مواظبشون هست.
I've seen, watched people.
من دیدم مردمی رو که.
And I've known people over the years. Who just, they could probably in one evening like this connect with almost everybody in the whole group.
من کسایی دیدم که دیدن مثل طول سالیان یک شخصایی بودن که میتونستن در یک همچین گروهی با تک تک افراد در یک ارتباطی قرار بگیرن.
Somehow they could walk among the flock and touch almost everybody meaningfully in some way.
و میتونن یه جوری در میان این افراد راه برن که هر کدوم اینها رو طوری به صورت خیلی معنیدار اینا رو لمس کنن.
So the shepherds care for people.
بنابراین شبان به فکر مردم هست.
And they are just watching out for them.
و با اونا رو مواظبشون هستش.
Now you may say, I wonder if there aren't several of these that are like me.
شاید بهت فکر بکنید که چند تا از این هدیه‌ها من هستم.
And that could be.
و ممکنم باشه.
Teaching.
حالا آموزش.
It means to instruct.
آموزش دادن یا تعلیم دادن.
It's to help people understand and clearly explain and apply the word of God in its fullness to the listeners, leading them to maturity in Christ.
یعنی کمک کردن به مردم که بتونن بفهمن و به طور روشن بهشون آموزش داده بشه و بتونن اون کلام خدا رو به کار ببرن در پوری و اینکه گوش بکنن و هدایت بشن به همون رشد مسیح.
They will often do this in great detail.
ولی خیلی وقتا این در خیلی جزئیات انجام میشه.
You might wonder, well, how could they find so much in one little verse?
من ممکنه شما بگید در یه آیه میگوشی که چقدر چیزا شما میتونید پیدا بکنید.
But they will teach in great detail the whole word of God.
ولی اینها قادر هستند در یک چیز کوچیک یک بسیار توضیح بدن کلام خدا.
Jesus himself was the master teacher.
و خود عیسی مسیح استاد آموزش بود.
Whereas apostles, prophets, and evangelists instruct the believers and non-believers, pastors or shepherds and teachers minister mostly among those that already believe.
در حالی که فرستاده‌ها و پیشروها و مباشرها آموزش میدن ایمانداران و غیر ایماندارا رو و همینطور کشیش‌ها رو شبان‌ها رو و معلم‌ها رو برای کار خدمتشون در میان اونایی که ایماندار هستن.
Now, I think you're going to have questions when I'm done. Because I'm not explaining everything. Wisdom. Is the literal meaning is to apply truth to life. To apply the truths of God to the God of the universe to situations in which people find themselves.
در قسمت‌های مختلف زندگی در این زندگی که مردم برای خودشون دارن.
It's my hope that you will find people among you who are wise.
من دوست دارم شما ببینید پیدا کنید آدمایی که در میان شما حکیم هستن.
They don't put on their shoulder I am wise.
اینا در لباسشون نذاشتن که من حکیم هستم.
But somehow you just know.
ولی یه جورایی شما خودتون متوجه میشید.
That these are people that you would like to talk to if you are in trouble of some kind.
شما اونا رو پیدا میکنی یه جورایی که اینا حکمت اونا که وقتی مشکل دارید بتونید با اونا صحبت کنید.
Knowledge.
بعد حالا دانش یا شناخت.
It just means to know.
یعنی دانستن.
To know the truth of God obtained by spirit by the spirit through study of scripture or by direct revelation.
دانستن حقیقت‌های خدا با به دست آوردن طریق روح مقدس با مطالعه کتاب مقدس و همینطور مکاشفه مستقیم.
It's a little bit different than wisdom.
یه خود فرق می‌کنه با حکمت.
Because wisdom is about application.
برای اینکه حکمت در مورد بکارگیری هست.
How the truth might apply to you.
چجوری حقیقت به تو میتونه کار بکنه.
But knowledge is the information by itself.
در مورد که دانش یک اطلاعاتی برای خودش هست.
Encouragement or exhortation.
حالا در مورد تشویق کردن.
It means to come alongside.
یعنی که با کسی در کنار کسی بودن، اومدن.
It's to present truth both or to strengthen and comfort or to correct or urge to action.
در واقع حقیقت رو تو باز کردن و برای تقویت کردن، برای آرامش دادن، برای تسلیم کردن و همینطور برای یک کار فوری انجام دادن. برای فوری
they can comfort or challenge people to behave according to what they already know.
همینطوره آدم‌ها رو آرامش بده، همینطوره اونا رو به چالش بکشن و کسایی رو که میدونن اونا رو میشناسن که در یک مسائلی هستن.
When I first began to hear about spiritual gifts,
من دفعه اول که در مورد هدایای روحانی شنیدم،
I knew that this was me.
من می‌دونستم این هم من هستم.
Because I realized that for me it's not so much loving the information and teaching it, it's helping people who know it to apply it.
برای اینکه من خودم می‌دونستم که مثلا برای من هدیه این نیست که فقط اینا رو این اطلاعات کلام خدا رو بخونم یا درس بدم، بلکه اونها رو به کار بگیرم برای کمک کردن به مردم.
Administration.
حالا کار اداری کردم.
The literal meaning is to pilot a ship or to govern it.
در واقع معنی لغویش یعنی هدایت کردن یک گوسفند یا اداره کردن.
Causing the diverse
اداره کردن مثلا کشتی.
It's causing the diverse parts of the ship to work together so that a common purpose and direction are achieved.
باعث این میشه که بتونیم قسمت‌های مختلف اون کشتی بتونه با هم دیگه کار بکنه، با هم دیگه برای یک مقصود مشترک در یک جهت و یک مقصود.
Perhaps it's a little bit like the conductor of an orchestra.
مثل یک رهبر یک ارکستر مثلا.
So we need to hear from these people over here.
مثلا ما خوش دوست داریم از آدم‌ها اینجا بشنویم. باید بگی خود بگیم اینجا آروم باشن، یه خیلی قوی از اینجا بشنویم.
So it's getting them all to work together.
اینطوری اینا رو همه رو در کنار هم قرار بدیم.
I have noticed this, that some people prefer the administration of information and others the administration of people.
بعضی ها من شنیدم که بعضی دوست دارن که کار اداری برای مردم باشن، بعضی ها برای فقط اطلاعات.
Leading.
حالا هدایت کردن.
Literally it means to stand before.
به نظر لغوی این جور ایستادن.
It's somebody who is set over others or presides or superintends.
در واقع کسی است که جلو میسته و در واقع هدایت میکنه.
It appears 8 times in Paul's writings, mostly to do with leading a family or an elder who directs the church.
در واقع 8 بار در نامه‌های پولس تکرار شده به طور اغلب در که بیشتر در جهت هدایت خانواده هستش به عنوان یک یک پیر که هدایت میکنه یک کلیسا رو به یک شماس.
You know, sometimes there are many people who speak, but it seems like nobody is listening.
بعض وقت اینگاه به نظر میسه خیلی دارن صحبت و اون هیچ کس گوش نمیکنه.
People who lead effectively somehow are able to influence people to move together in a direction they wouldn't have gone on their own.
اما آدمایی که این قول هدیه هدایت رو دارن میتونن همه مردم طوری توجهشون جلب کنن که همه بتونن درست صحبت کنن و گوش کنن.
Mercy.
حالا قسمت دلسوزی یا
to have compassion.
یعنی رحم داشتن.
This is my wife's gift.
این هدیه خانم من هست.
It's to have pity in the face of misery, to cheerfully or gently comfort those that are in trouble, suffering or in need.
در واقع رحم داشتن در زمانی که سختی هست بتونیم اونها رو با خوشحالی و به آرامی اونها رو آرامش بدیم، در زمانی که سختی دارن و رنج هستن و در نیاز.
Some of you know that she has had breast cancer.
بعضی شما ممکنه بدونی که خانم من سرطان سینه داره.
So she's been going every day for treatment over the last few weeks.
در این چند هفته گذشته هر روز میره برای همین کار درمانش.
And almost every day she's coming home with something to say.
و هر روز وقتی خونه میاد یه چیزی برای گفتن داره.
Because she has compassion on these people who are all getting treatments there.
برای اینکه این زن من این هدیه رحم و شفقت رو داره در وجودش برای کسانی که باهاش دارن کار میکنن.
And so she is sharing her heart and her life with them.
برای اینکه میره و به اشتراک میذاره قلبش رو با اونها.
And every day I come home and I say, so what happened today?
Perhaps که من میرم خودم میگم امروز چه اتفاقی افتاد.
Because she is showing compassion to people that she is meeting there.
برای اینکه اون شفقت خودش رو به اونهایی که با اونها ملاقات میکنه نشون میده.
There are supernatural healings.
بعد حالا شفاهای خارق‌العاده هستش.
The literal meaning is to restore instantaneously.
به نظر لغوی یعنی کسی رو بازسازی کردن بلافاصله.
Usually used in the Bible of physical healing, but a few times of spiritual healing.
در کتاب مقدس بعضی از شفاهای جسمی هست، هم شفاهای روحی.
Now you have to understand that all healings are temporary.
ولی یادتون باشه تمامی این شفاها به طور موقت.
Because eventually we will all die.
برای اینکه ما هممون خواهیم مرد.
So if somebody is healed of something, they may be well for quite a long period of time.
ممکنه برای مدتی خیلی خوب باشه.
But eventually they will die.
ولی سرانجام خواهند مرد.
Does that mean they were not healed? Well, there could be some confusion about that. And sometimes there is confusion about
it.
Miracles. Literal meaning is to do powerful deeds or workings of power. It's to authenticate the ministry and message of God through supernatural interventions which glorify Him.
در واقع یک انجام دادن یک خدمت و پیامی رو از طرف خدا از طریق یک عمل خارق‌العاده که خدا رو جلال بده.
Now, the thing is, we may say, well, so why don't we see these like all the time?
چون ممکنه شما سوال بکنید چرا ما همیشه این چیزا رو نمی‌بینیم ز معجزات خارق‌العاده رو.
So we say, well, we heard of this person that healed over there, but my mother is sick, and why don't you heal her? Or a miracle is needed here. Why don't we always get the miracle we wanted? Miracles were often seen in Jesus, but also in others. When he changed the water to wine, that was a miracle. Healings are also referred to as miracles in the Gospels. And sometimes people have tried to manufacture healings and miracles.
بعض وقتا بعضی ها بودن که این معجزات و شفاها رو سعی کردن بسازن اینجوری تولید کنن.
We don't have any way of creating healings and miracles on demand.
اینطوری نیست که ما بیایم به اساس تقاضای آدم ها یک معجزه ای رو یک کار فوق شفایی رو انجام بدیم.
There are times when healings occur.
زمانی هست که شفاها اتفاق میفته.
And other times they are not happening.
و بعد وقتا اصلا اتفاق نمیفته.
The Apostle Paul himself healed other people.
همین پولس رسول خودش کسایی بود که شفا میداد.
But he himself had physical health problems.
خودش مشکل بدنی داشت، جسمی داشت.
And so the timing and frequency of healings and miracles are not up to us.
بنابراین زمان و مدت این شفاها ربطی به ما رسیده، ما ربطی نداره.
But there are some people who have very bold faith when it comes to these things.
ولی کسایی هستن که یک ایمان بسیار بسیار فوق‌العاده دارن وقتی در این مسائل می‌رسن.
And it's a blessing when they are among us.
و واقعا برکتی هستن وقتی در میان ما هستن.
Distinguishing or discerning of spirits.
و بعد تشخیص ارواح هستش.
It means literally to make a distinction or to separate.
یعنی در واقع از لغوی یعنی جدا کردن.
It's the ability to discern between wholesome teaching and false teaching.
مثلا تشخیص اینه که این آموزش درست یا آموزش غلط هست.
Sometimes people will listen to a teaching and say, I just feel like there's something not quite right here.
مثلا بعضی هستی که میتونن گوش بکنن به یه آموزش میگن نه این نمیتونه کاملا درست باشه.
There are people who sound like they are prophets, but are they true prophets or false prophets?
آیا مثلا این آدم ها که دارن پیشگویی میکنن پیشگوهای یا نبیهای واقعی هستن یا دروغی؟
There will be times when there is confusion among us.
زمان هایی میبینیم که بین ما یه سرگیجه میبینیم گیج میشیم.
And we need to have people among us who have this sense.
این زمان هاست که ما لازم در میان ما کسانی باشن که این حس رو داشته باشن.
So that we are not fooled.
که نه گول نخوریم.
There can be true and false healings or miracles.
برای اینکه میتونه هم شفاها و هم معجزات قلابی وجود داشته.
There can be demonic activity and wholesome activity.
و حتی میتونه یه سری کارهای شریرانه و شریر باشه.
There can be hidden motives and true motives.
و میتونه هم انگیزه های مخفیانه باشه هم واقعی باشه.
Speaking in tongues.
حالا صحبت به زبان ها.
And interpretation of tongues.
و ترجمه زبان ها.
Literally speaking in tongues means speaking in languages. Without this, we can't speak. It can be spontaneously speaking in known languages that one has never learned or spoken before.
مثلا صحبت کردن به یه زبانی به طور اتوماتیک به زبانی که اصلا تا حالا نشنیدیم و اصلا آشنایی باش نداشتیم.
This is what happened in Acts chapter 2.
و این در اعمال رسولان باب 2 اتفاق افتاد.
Or it may be to speak in a language that is understood only by God or through someone with the gift of interpretation of such a language.
یا صحبت کردن به زبانی که فقط خدا اون رو میفهمه یا ترجمه.
Uninterpreted can edify oneself or done privately.
و چیزی که ترجمه نشده میتونه یک نفر رو به شکل شخصی فنا بکنه.
There's probably been more debate and confusion about this than almost anything else.
و بسیار بسیار بحث‌های زیادی در این مورد در کتاب اومده و خیلی ها بین همه هست.
And there's a good reason for it.
و یک دلیل خیلی خوبی هست برای.
Because when you hear a language that you don't know.
برای اینکه وقتی شما زبانهایی رو میشنوید که نمیدونید.
And you have no way of knowing.
و هیچ راهی هم نداری که بدونید درست یا نه.
You are confused.
به فکرش میشید.
Somebody can tell you almost anything about it.
برای اینکه هر کسی در مورد این چیزی بگه بالاخره.
But there is such a thing.
اما همین چیزی وجود داره.
And then there is this foundational gift of faith.
و بعد این هدیه بنیادی ایمان هستش.
It's to trust or to have confidence or to believe.
یعنی اعتماد داشتن از نظر لغوی و اعتماد داشتن و ایمان داشتن.
To become a child of God through Jesus, one must practice faith. You can't get it any other way.
کسی که بخواد فرزند خدا بشه از طریق عیسی مسیح نیاز به ایمان داره.
But people can have small faith or big faith.
بعضی میتونن ایمان کم داشته باشن، بعضی ایمان زیاد.
Some are said to have faith that can move mountains.
بعضی همچین ایمان داره که میتونن کوه رو انتقال بدن.
Now the truth is, I've never actually seen any mountains actually move.
ولی حقیقت اینه که کسی نتونه اصلا همچین ایمانی کوه رو انتقال بده.
So this is a figure of speech.
این فقط یک شکل هست از صحبت.
It refers to the fact that there may be great faith or small faith.
فقط صحبت رو نمی کنه که بتونه ایمان بسیار بالایی وجود داشته باشه یا ایمان بسیار کم.
There are people who believe the unbelievable because they have a clear grasp of the invisible. Believing God is in it.
و هست کسایی که ایمان دارن که به اون چیزایی که غیر قابل اعتماد هست برای اینکه اونها میتونن یک فهم خیلی روشنی از چیزهای غیر قابل دیدن دارن و اعتماد دارن در که خدا در اون هست.
I have been with people with great faith.
من کسایی بودم که با ایمان‌های بسیار بزرگ.
And I thought to myself, I think I, compared to them, I only have a little faith.
وقتی خودم با اونها مقایسه کردم، آه، فقط من ایمان کمی دارم.
So that when we have people among us who have this great faith,
وقتی ما کسایی داریم که بین ما که ایمان بسیار بزرگی دارن,
they are a blessing to us.
اینها برکت‌های.
They may believe things that actually don't make even any sense to us.
ممکنه چیزهایی رو به ما بگن که اصلا برای ما معنی نداشته باشه.
Doesn't mean it's not true.
این به معنی نیست که درست نیست.
And then there are support gifts. The literal meaning is to take the place of someone or to take on a burden to oneself. Jesus came to serve. The Spirit comes to help us in our weakness. So helping or serving might seem to some of us that that's only a small gift.
شاید برای بعضی از ما کمک کردن و خدمت کردن فقط یه هدیه خیلی کوچیکی باشه.
But you know Jesus came to serve.
اما بدونید که عیسی مسیح اومد که خدمت کنه.
The Holy Spirit serves.
روح القدس خدمت میکنه.
Such people can help with anything.
همچین آدمایی با همچین هدیه میتونن به هر چیزی خدمت کنن.
The Bible uses this of helping the weak. General assistance in ministry could be caring for widows. You see these cement blocks around this building? In between every block there is mortar.
سیمان هست.
Without the mortar, they don't hold together.
بدون این سیمان اینا نمیتونه بغل هم بیستن.
People who have the gift of helping can squish in and fit in any place.
اینایی که هدیه کمک دارن هر جایی خودشون رو یه جوری جا میدن.
They can see that something needs to be done here, that something has to fit into that little space.
و میفهمن بلافاصله که در این جای کوچولو باید یه چیزی انجام بشه، بنابراین همه جا خودشون جا بکنن، اونجا بتونن کمک بکنن.
There is the gift of giving.
هدیه اهدا نمودن هست.
We're all called to give.
همه ما خوانده شدیم که اهدا کنیم.
But some people give with a special freedom.
و بعضی با یک آزادی عجیب اهدا میکنن.
It's to give a part of something or to share.
یعنی که یه چیزی رو سهم بود.
It often has to do with money in the Bible, but not always.
بیشتر وقتا که ما دست در برابر با پول هست، اما همیشه اینطور نیست.
Some years ago, we were starting an organization in Kitchener to reach out to the poor people in our community.
چند سال پیش در کیچنر یک سازمانی شروع کردیم برای کمک رسانی به آدمای فقیر.
And we were running out of money.
پولمون تموم شد.
Our landlord said, if you don't pay the rent by Tuesday night, he's going to lock the door.
و اون صاحبونه میگه به ما گفتش که اگه سه‌شنبه شب این پولی ندیم در رو میدونه تو قفل.
So we said, what are we going to do?
بعد باید گفتیم چی کار باییم حالا؟
We said, well, we have to do something. Why don't each of us call five or six people that we know and just tell them what's happening? We said, if we can each find six people that give us $300, we'll be paying the rent. You know, I didn't like to make these kind of phone calls. But I discovered that some people don't mind getting them. I phoned one man. And he was so pleased to help. Then he said, you know what? He's going to bring the money over right away tonight. I could tell how excited he was about this. And if we hadn't been in a big trouble, I never would have learned that. So there are people who are just watching and looking. They would like to help, but they want to help in a way that is meaningful. And when they find out what it is, boom, they're right there. Distributing, it's distributing one's wealth to others in the name of Christ and for the sake of His kingdom. Hospitality. You know what? I think you are all very good at this. I have the feeling that Persians are good at hospitality. Literally means to love strangers. It's providing friendship and food and shelter for people that we don't really know. It's required of elders or leaders in the church. And you should practice it without grumbling. So don't be very hospitable. And then afterwards you say, you know those people that we had. Don't do that. When people see us in our homes, they see us the way we really are. So if I come to your house, then I would say, oh. You know, now I know Sister Lina in a different way. Because I see where she lives. This is her home. And so we learn things about each other when we are in one another's homes. This is how different spiritual gifts respond to somebody who maybe goes to the hospital.
مثلا حالا این هدیه‌های مختلف می‌تونه اینطوری مشخص بشه مثلا برای یه نفری که تو بیمارستان هست.
The teacher might say, you know, I did some research on that illness of yours.
مثلا معلم میگه من در مورد این مریضی تو یه مقدار تحقیق کردم.
I think I can tell you exactly what's happening.
و من می‌تونم دقیقاً بهت بگم چه اتفاقی داره میفته.
The person who is the giver
اون کسی که اهدا کننده هست
might say well does your insurance cover this
ممکنه بهت بگه که آیا مثلا بیمه اینو پرداخت میکنه
because they are concerned about how you are doing
برای اونا نگرانه که این چی میتونه بشه
The encourager would say, well, how can we use what you're learning to help other people in the future? The prophet might say, well, so what do you think God is trying to teach you through this illness? The servant would say, now, I brought you a little gift. Now, I brought in your mail, and I fed the dog, and I watered the plants, and I washed your dishes. And the person, the mercy person says, I can't begin to tell you how I felt when I heard that you were so sick. How are you feeling now? When my wife asks somebody this question, They know that they are being asked sincerely. So she knows how to say this in a completely different way than I do. But I just wanted to show you the different ways in which people respond to the very same situation. Administration, don't worry about a thing. I've assigned your job before other people. How do I discover my gifts? Know about them. Which one of them sounds kind of like me? Practice the ones that might be you. And continue those that give you fulfillment and joy in doing
them.
And listen for affirmation from other people. There are two gifts that people have and they usually don't know that they have them. People who have the gift of mercy and helping or serving so often have said to me, I don't think I have a real gift. You know what? Because they do it so spontaneously and so readily that they don't think it's anything special. Anybody could do that. But I say, well, is everybody doing that? They say, no, some people just don't get it. And so over and over, I've seen this happening. That people who have these gifts say, I don't have
anything.
I like to say this, that we should do what we're gifted to do perhaps two-thirds of the time. And the remaining third, you should just do what needs to be done. And just be a servant. That's not in the Bible. There is no greater joy than to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so give him your heart and your mind. Give him your resources, your hands and your feet. And so I would love for each one of you to be able to look at yourself and to say, well, what do I have to offer? Because you're not just coming here to sit and listen. Or to eat food after. We're coming together to actually to build and strengthen each other. And let him reward you in his own time and way.
You will.
Amen.